as we're getting warmer weather in Seattle. So I think that might be a reason why a few people are a little bit late in coming this evening. But we're really privileged to welcome Hirokazu Koreeda this evening. I am Ken Oshima, professor of architecture and chair of University of Washington Japanese Studies Program. And so we are really pleased to welcome Koreeda-san for our final event for the Mitsubishi Corporation Lecture Series this year, which is focused on the arts of Japan. Bakugo, Nihonbuyo, and many other aspects. So Koreeda-san is here at our invitation in collaboration with the Seattle International Film Festival. The film festival is kicking off their whole slew of events tonight. So I know a few people had to actually go off for that, but this partnership has allowed us to really connect with our community and have the U.S. debut of the film After the Storm that will be showing tomorrow night at the Queen Anne venue, and then on Saturday afternoon at the Egyptian. So if you don't have tickets and are interested in going, I think there might be a possibility. I think they've been going very quickly, but it's definitely something to be seen, because we'll have a conversation afterwards with Koreeda-san about his whole perspective on making film. So this would not be possible without the tremendous generosity of the Mitsubishi Corporation. And so I would like to especially thank Toshi Kawachi, who is the Vice President of Mitsubishi Corporation. It is through their partnership that we are able to bring this lecture series to actually for the fourth year. We've had a whole range of lectures, but this is certainly an apex of this. And so again, let us thank you. So at this time, I'd like to introduce Professor Devinder Bhowmick of the University of Washington Department of Asian Languages and Literature. Professor Bhowmick teaches modern Japanese literature with a particular interest in fiction of Okinawa. And we just learned that Koreeda-san's wife has connections to Okinawa, and so there's a very interesting way that we're all connected. Professor Bhowmick is also the UW Japanese program coordinator. And also, most importantly, teaching a course this spring on Koreeda-san's film. And so I think many of the students that are here this evening, we're extremely fortunate to be able to see clips and talk with Koreeda-san, and I cannot think of actually anyone better to introduce Koreeda-san than Devinder. So without further ado, I'd like to ask you to say hello.
Thank you so much, Ken. It's really a pleasure. I have to pinch myself about how all the stars aligned to make this happen. A year ago, I mentioned to a colleague I wanted to teach Koreeda-san's films next time I had a film course, and that person said, well, maybe he'll come. It'll be time for the film festival. And I thought, yeah, right. And here he is. Thank you very, very much to Kawachi-san and his predecessor, Kawazoe-san, and to my colleagues in the UW Japan Studies program, Ken Ellen's been a wonderful help during this whole pre-planning of the event. I'd also like to thank Yuta Kaminishi and Chris Lowy for technical help tonight. So without further ado, let me introduce our guest, Koreeda Hirokazu, who is a filmmaker, a producer, screenwriter, and editor, who is from Tokyo. Mr. Koreeda received his undergraduate degree from Waseda University, and although he aspired to be a novelist, he began his career as an assistant director of documentaries for TV Man Union. These documentaries led to a career in film, and today he has his own company called Bangku Production. His first feature film, Maboroshi, appeared in 1995 and won the Grand Osella Prize at the Venice Film Festival. Perhaps best known for Nobody Knows, from 2004, and Like Father, Like Son, 2013, Mr. Koreeda has directed one film after another, covering an astonishing range of topics, from grief that some of you may remember from Maboroshi, to childhood in many, many films, Nobody Knows, Kiseki, I Wish, and Hana, Yorimo Now, to vengeance in the samurai film, Hana Yorimo Now. These films have won Mr. Koreeda a number of awards. Besides the Golden Osella, Mr. Koreeda won Best Film and Best Screenplay for Afterlife, called Wonderful Life in Japanese, Wandakuru Dai. That might remind you of another movie you've seen. In 2004, he won Best Film and Best Director for Nobody Knows. And in 2009, he won Best Director for Still Walking, Aruite mo, Aruite mo. In 2013, at the Cannes Film Festival, Mr. Koreeda won the Jury Award for Like Father, Like Son, soshite chichi ni naru. And with each passing year, the list grows longer. 2015, at the Yokohama Film Festival, he won Best Director for Our Little Sister. Some of you may have seen that here in Seattle last year. In 2016, Best Film for the film that will be screening at SIFF Friday and Saturday. My own interest in Koreeda-san's work derives from the documentary style that is a characteristic of the early work of Mr. Koreeda. I think that those elements of documentary are pronounced in his featured films, and this blurring between documentary and feature or narrative film is one that that I think of along the lines of a question that many of us in Japanese literature think about, the line between fiction and nonfiction. Sometimes it's not so clear. So Mr. Koreeda blurs these lines in creating his film, lines that is between documentary and narrative film, and also I think between media. To hear about in the Q&A, if you're interested. And by that I mean that even while I watch film by Koreeda-san, I feel that actually what I'm watching is, or what I'm experiencing is poetry in motion. So with that, I'd like you to join me in thanking Mr. Koreeda for coming to the University of Washington and agreeing to take part in the conversation that will follow.
number of questions. Some of the questions will have a visual, a clip from one of Mr. Cuenda's films. Chris on the side will be showing us the clips in order of my questions. So I think what we'll do is look at the first clip first, and then I'll raise a question. So this is a clip from the end of Laboroshi.
Why is this phantasmic 캐머니아로 그래서 그가 카타테르 마도로시만 시카린 도예요.
The original script, The Phantasmic Light, refers to.
다만 주인공 오토가 카타르 고우미 노 고우니 고 스미가 캐라리아 도 시카테 인간을 호시에 사서 그런 시카린 도.
This refers to the man who looks across the sea and sees the glistening sea and the light that's beckoning him. This might be the light that you were
referring to. When I wanted
to depict this in a film, I didn't want to take it so literally. That was my point of departure.
それをとらずに、どんなふうに日常の空間の中に光と闇みたいなものをきちんと取るかっていうことを考えて撮ってる映画ではあります。
I am consciously thinking about how to combine these two opposing forces of light and darkness.
ちょっともう20年、25年前なので、記憶があやふやなのかな。恥ずかしいですね。まあ当時はいろんなことを考えてこういうふうになってるんですけど、今考えてやっぱこう、なんつったんですかね、ストレートにやりたいことが見えて、 ベネチアの映画祭に初めての作品で行かせていただいて、向こうでトランアンユンっていうベトナム出身のフランスの監督がいて。
I went to the Venice Film Festival, and this film was shown there, and there was a director from Vietnam who was present.
それ仲良くなったんですけど。 彼はこの映画、彼はすごく日本文学にも通じていて、僕なんかよりもずっといろんなものを読んでる。And
he was very knowledgeable.
男です。
And this Vietnamese man was so knowledgeable about Japanese literature, much more than I am.
それで、上映後のパーティーであったとき、僕が日本人になって分かったもんだから、すごく漱石のこととか、渋谷直美のダサいの。
And the post party recognized that I was Japanese and he would ask me questions about Shiranaya and Soseki, and I was taken aback because I couldn't answer any of his questions.
So, looking at watching this film, he said to me,
this must be based on.
ジュニチ・タニザキ's film.
It's exactly what I had been reading when I created this, so I was
So he called me.
That's it.
I realized
that I shouldn't be doing stuff like that.
And
I remember that and I became very embarrassed again.
Thank you.
that the impact of Akira's sister's death makes him absent for a while. When the light changes, you see the overexposed scenes. And then at the end, in the Shokan Dai, or the street, shopping street, when the name Akira is called, he snaps out of that absence or trauma that the sister's death has put him in. So this is an example of the kind of texture, rich texture, that I see in Koreeda-san's films. I'm not sure if I'm using the word correctly, but I think of it as a kind of synesthesia that is that when I'm viewing the films, I feel that I'm also feeling them, tasting them. They're often food scenes, food prep scenes. I'm smelling things. I'm experiencing events on different levels. So there are plenty of sounds. I think Nobody Knows captures the sound of childhood in an incredible way. There are the squeaky shoes of Yuki, the little sister who dies. There's the chill of the karupi's ice in another film. The taste of tomorokoshi tempura that is fried. The smell of Akira from this film after the gas bill isn't paid and the water's cut off in the home they live in. Your treatment of children is extraordinary. You show viewers the delights of childhood from the Kumamoto sleepover in I Wish. We'll see that in a moment. Melon popsicles, eating crumbs at the bottom of a bag of chips, and the list goes on. What I'd like to ask about children in particular is what has working with children taught you about filmmaking?
ポテトチップの中に残っているポテトチップのカスをまとめて口に入れるの
がすごく味が濃くてうまい。それが一番好きで、それをどっちが食べるかで兄ちゃんといつも喧嘩する。
So when I asked the boys what they like, what kind of snacks they liked the best, the younger brother said potato chips. Not only potato chips, but he liked to eat the last bits of potato chips in the potato chip bag, and he would end up arguing with his brother, older brother, as to who was the one who was going to be able to eat those last fantastic, flavorful bits of chips.
そういうの僕、男兄弟がいないから、経験がなかったから、面白いなと思って、そういう彼らから出てきたアイディアをそのまま脚本に書き込んで作ってるシーンが、IBC という映画がすごく多いんですけど。
So I don't have a male sibling, so this kind of scene was very refreshing to me.
それも僕もらってくる。
And I incorporated these scenes in my films, and I learned a lot about children.
Some of you might not know that the brothers, the actors who play brothers in I Wish are brothers themselves, and I think that adds another incredible dimension to the sibling depiction. Doesn't have a clip, but I'll ask it, and you can imagine a scene from one of the films of Corea da Sam. I've been wondering since I watched Mahoroshi or re-watched it with my class this term about sound in his films. In Mahoroshi, there is a lot of focus on the bicycle bell that belong to the husband of Yumiko, the one who commits suicide and who she is grieving over. And from the sound of that bell in Mahoroshi to Koreeda-san's more recent films, I keep hearing this ringing of a bell. It's not always a bell. Sometimes it's a wind chime. Sometimes it's another sound that's similar. So when I hear the sound of a bell, I know I'm watching Koreeda-san's films. And for me, the bell has a kind of Pavlovian effect. I hear the bell, and I'm not hypnotized, but something happens to me. The effect is so immediate. So as I said, this starts from early on in 1995 and continues. There's the bike bell, and it continues to sound throughout Koreeda-san's oeuvre. In Seattle, a bell wards off bears. What import does the sound of a bell or a wind chime have in your work?
でも音の風鈴は多分いろんなところで使ってるのはやっぱり空あれじゃないですか、ね、目に見えないものをこう具現化できるというか風とか空気の流れって多分取れなかなか取れないかななんか揺れてるものとか意外と好きで撮ってるんですよね。
That it's a way to depict something that is intangible, something that's abstract, like wind or air. It's a concrete way of portraying that,
conveying that. 味とか匂いもそうですけど、映画では撮れないので、そうなるとそれをご想起してもらうためには、それに伴っている音をどう丁寧に拾っていくかっていうことがすごく重要なんですね。
So even in conveying things like smell. Maybe I use sound like the wind chimes to convey
味は伝わらないから音でっていうことで、テプラ揚げの音もそうですし、何かを聞いている音とか、まな板に包丁が当たる音とか、そういうこと自分の中にある記憶の部分が大きいですけども、そういう音によってイメージを膨らませるということはかなり意識的にはやっています。
So in the cooking scenes, for example, in the scenes where there's tempura and there's oil that's kind of sizzling or the sound of knives hitting against the wooden cutting board, I'm trying to convey to my audience something that can, a taste that cannot be conveyed otherwise. So through other senses, I attempt to convey this taste. I haven't really been thinking so specifically about the use of the Ling Chai as I was making this, but it's interesting.
ああ、はいはい、自転車のルーツ、住むやつね。そうですね。ありますね、意外とね。そう、好きな先生の自転車のベルを盗むっていう。
Oh, yes. There's a boy who steals the bell off the bicycle of his favorite teacher. Yes. Yes.
ちょっと意識してないから逆にすごくもしかするとすごい深いのかもしれない。深いところが来てる。
I didn't include that consciously, so maybe it comes from a much deeper place.
Okay, thank you. We're going to go on to another clip. So clip four. This is a clip from Wanda Fukudai for Afterlife.
I feel like I've been interrogated in a psychologist's office.
記憶に遡って思い出すことができるということが今の医学では分かってるらしいです。
最初、
地球の中と同じようにこう目をつぶってね、水の中に漂って母親に包まれた安定した自分の記憶を蘇らせることによって。精神的な病気とか不安を取り除こうとしているらしい。いや、これ本当の話。
数字の1に月の5です。
Okay, so I selected this scene because it was the one that lingered in my mind after watching the film. And as you saw at the beginning, the gentleman who's speaking states that there are some people who can recall memories from being in the womb, being in a watery sack.The scene that follows has a counselor, female counselor, who is submerging herself, I think, in an attempt to recapture memories that she can't recall. So what I enjoyed about this film is scenes such as the one you just saw.Given the Japanese title of the film, Wanda Furu Life, Wonderful Life, I imagine that one of the inspirations for Koreeda-san might have been the American film, It's a Wonderful Life, in which retracing one's past is the central plot line. And in your film, a young female counselor attempts to capture her earliest personal memories. But in the same film, some interviewees, the premise of the film is to
have those who have died but not yet moved on capture one memory that they will take with them for eternity. So some interviewees also speak about Japan's history, particularly its wartime past. Some of them talk about World War II. One of them talks about the Nini no Mujiken from earlier on. So my question has to do with these moments in the film. What are the ways in which you ask your viewers to reflect on Japan's past and why?
So I probably wanted people
reflect on scenes like that, moments like that, and think about what they would select as their single memory if the question was posed to them.
Thank you. So Chris, we could see the next clip. This is a clip from the end of Air Doll, which is a story about a doll that transforms into a human. It's a very good escape.
Thank you.
So I'd like to segue now to this film, which interests me a great deal because of the temporality of it. The story, as I said, depicts the miraculous life and abject suicide of Nozomi, an air doll. And for me, it addresses both Japan's contemporary moment, impacted by neoliberalism, globalism, globalization, that is, the efficiency with which corporations and companies replace human labor with non-human labor. The air doll's owner is one of these disposable types, works at a restaurant, but there are many other people behind him should he lose his job, or even non-human replacements. So that's the contemporary temporality. There's also the past, as we saw in Afterlife, that's invoked. Particularly when one considers Koreeda's choice of the actress who plays the air doll. The fact that Nozomi goes from an object to someone with a heart and subjectivity frees her somewhat from an easy overlap or conflation that some viewers might make between her and what a few of my students noticed before I said anything, and that is a so-called comfort woman. What interests me most about air doll is not Nozomi per se, but rather the fact that with her dying breath, as this scene showed, she sends spores of a dandelion to so many other people, her owner lying in bed with another air doll that replaces Nozomi, also named Nozomi, the old man who's on oxygen, the shut-in who opens the window at the end where light streams in. Why do you connect Nozomi to these other characters? And does this have something to do with past and present? Another moment from the past takes place when we have an allusion to an incident from 1936, the Abe Sada Chiken, or incident of a crime.
その好きな男の人が息を吹き込んでくれるんですよね。で、それまで自分が空気人形だということをすごく、コンプレックスとして考えてた彼女が、その時初めて他人の息で満たされるっていうことを経験して、喜びを感じるんですよね。<笑>
manga by a woman by the name of Goda Yoshie. And there is what's called a Dutch wife, who is the inflatable sex partner. And so in the story, and in the film and also in the manga, this character works in a video store and falls in love with an employee there, the manager of this video store. But she's punctured by a nail and air is released, and this store manager blows air into her. And before that moment, she had a complex that she wasn't real, but through incorporating this air from a human being, she feels redeemed and happy.
So
basically, the ending is tragic, but I don't want you to interpret it that way, because what happens at the end is that, you know, the inflatable doll feels redeemed and senses the possibility that it gains through the breath of another person. The directors talk about these things. There are a lot of lies incorporated.
So there's the Korean actor who portrays
the protagonist here.
ペドナはとにかく非常に、まあ、マンボウが彼女が入ってる韓国映画を見に来て、なんとかして彼女を取るチャンスがないかと思っていたんですけど、この役だったら要するに日本語ができなくてもいいので、で徐々に言葉を覚えていくっていうプロセスをそのままできるから、で日本人ではない存在を通して今の東京を
many movies with Pegna in it, and I wanted to be able to have her act in one of my films. Now, she is Korean, and she didn't know Japanese, so in the movie, she had to acquire language, and my intention was to be able to incorporate her in my film.
We discussed the fact that it is fitting that a non-Japanese plays the role, because the doll that transforms acquires culture, acquires language, and so it makes logical sense. So I have one last question, and then we'll open it up to the audience. I think there are probably many of you who have your own questions. This is the final clip for the evening, and it is a clip from I Wish. I had some trouble with this one, so it may not.
Clear. And then just play it. にしてもらえるとね。
いや、自分で。
そりゃね。
Sorry about the poor quality, that's my view.
明日早いよ。
明日
早いよ。
明日
早
いよ。Okay, so it's a very brief scene, but it's one of many scenes of hair combing that we noticed over the term in Koreeda-san's films. And so I wanted to discuss it in terms of family. As a unit or otherwise, to give just one example, we discussed three hair combing scenes. One in I Wish, another in Nobody Knows, when the mother is telling the young girl why she can't go to school because she wants to, and the mom says to her, kids without fathers are bullied at school, so it's better for you not to go to school. And then there's a third hair combing scene we discussed in class this week. So in this film, I Wish, the poor clip you just saw shows a non-biological mother and daughter relation that forms despite no ties between these two individuals. In Nobody Knows, there's a biological tie, mother and daughter, but there's also neglect. In your first feature film, Maboroshi, Yumiko remarries, presenting a kind of continuation of tradition, perhaps. But more recent films, like I Wish and After the Storm, which some of us will see this weekend, show the breakup of marriage and family. So I wanted to ask, what does family mean in your filmmaking, or has it changed over time? Yes.
今選んでいただいたシーンは実はすごく好きなシーンなので、ちょっと嬉しかったんですけど、髪を解く。
なぜですか？なぜかはね、髪をこうしてるのが好きなんですよね。なんですかね。
いわゆ
る幻の深いのがいるし。
Yes, in Maboroshi,
everybody
knows, and it's too long. Yeah, I think I do it a lot. I don't know.
There's
a scene where a mother who is unable to brush the hair of her own biological child gets to brush the hair of a young lady, a daughter. And likewise, a young girl who is unable to have her hair brushed by her biological mother is now able to have her hair brushed by
その隣で一緒にあの家に泊まった友達たちが布団の上で足を上げてるのが、あれ多分ね、あれはその場であの子たちが始めちゃって慌てて取りに行って使ったんですけど、本当はあれね、足でね、YMCA を
打ってた。YMCA。So that scene where you saw the little boys on the 布団 with their legs up in the air, they had done that on their own, and so I ran to get the camera to capture that, and what they were actually doing was, with their legs, doing YMCA.
So 面白くて。
That was hysterical.
あれ別の本当にあの別の部屋で別のシーンを撮ってた時に隣の部屋で始めちゃったからうるさくて撮影ができないので、それに行ってみたら面白かったので、慌てて回したんですけど。
So I had been filming in another room and there was a racket going on next door and I went to see what it was all about and that is what I saw and I ran to get my camera to capture that.
日本で公開したバージョンはね、YMCA って撮ってるんですよ。
So in the Japanese version, you can actually see the kids dancing with their, using their legs to dance YMCA.
YMCA の権利が高くて。
The rights to YMCA are so outrageous.
外へ出すのをカットせざるを得
なくて。But we had to cut it for the international version.
それで YMCA になる前にシーンが終わってる。
And so it's before YMCA starts that we had to cut the scene for you. It's really unfortunate.So please look at the
Thank you so much. And with that, we'll open up to the audience for any questions you'd like to ask.
ツーショットとか多分結構構図としてはなかなかない構図なのでだいたい2人の人に向き合うか横に並ぶかぐらいしか多分できないあれ後ろに立つでしょうあの形がちょっと好きなんじゃないですか
Another reason why I think I like the scenes of the hairbrushing is because it's one of the rare instances where you have two actors that are facing the same directionRarely do you have a situation like that. Sometimes you may have two people side by side, but it's rare, and maybe that's one of the reasons why.
だってやっぱり視線をどう切り取っていくかっていうのはすごく大事なんですけど、ノーバディノーズとかだと多分あの前に鏡があって、鏡の中にいる母親を見ながら。実態は同じ方向を向いていて視線がこう鏡の中の母親と交差するみたいなことを多分やってたと思うんですけどそういうちょっとこう手の込んだことがやりやすいシーンなんですよね
So you're one is always conscious of perspectives in the creation of the film and in the film Nobody Knows there is a scene where an individual is looking at a windowSo it's through looking at the window that they see the mother. So they see through the mirror, they see the mother. And nobody knows. So I think I found a scene like this, scenes like this particularly interesting because in the scene with the mirror, the individual is looking at the mother who is being reflected in the mirror. They're essentially looking in the same direction, but you're capturing a different perspective.
Okay, questions? Yes.
First of all, thank you for all the films you've given us. It's been a great experience. And the question is, what prompted you to interview 600 old people?
で選んだものをプレゼンテーションしてもらってその中で僕がチョイスをするってちょっと変わったやり方をしたんですけどそのことによって語られる思い出のバリエーション のこう多様性を確保したかった。自分で全部描くと多分自分の好みなものになりそうだったんですね。それで5人のスタッフにビデオカメラを持ってもらって毎日東京の街をさまよってもらって毎週土曜日にその映像を持ち寄ってプレゼンをしてもらうっていうやり方で脚本を作りました。
So it wasn't, I wasn't the only one conducting the interviews. It was my staff, about 5 people, who carried cameras and interviewed people in Tokyo. And I selected the interviews from among the interviews that they presented to me. In doing so, I wanted to be able to I wanted for there to be some kind of diversity. I didn't want it to be solely my selections. And on Saturday, they would make these presentations to me, and I would select them.
600人になったのは、最後が面白かったから。
The reason why we had 600 is probably because it was just so fascinating.
大変貴重な経験だったんです。
Very memorable, significant experience for us. Yes, please.
About the relationship between the non-biological father, for example, Hannah, like father, like son, still walking, and we will be now in this case, the relationship between the father, who is not the biological father, sometimes the stepfather, sometimes the adopted aborigine.And the child that is welcoming or is prospectively welcoming in the probably future household. Thank you.
So the relationshipBetween the non-biological father and the son figure.
Maboroji, still walking, Hannah, and like father, like son.
Yeah, there's quite a few out there. Why, I wonder.
なんか一回読んだようだけど、あんまり考えてないな。か、つか逆に言うと父親っていうものを考えるためにそういうシチュエーションをできてるかもしれないですね。
Maybe in thinking about the role of the father, I created different situations.
自覚、多分そのシチュエーションは自覚的にならないと。
It's because you have to become a father to sense the possibility, think of the possibility of that situation.
Yeah, 主人公が要するに父親になるということを意識的にならざるを得ない状況っていうのを作っている気がしますね。
I'm creating, probably creating, instances where there is no other alternative but for the father to become, that father figure.
Like father, like son以降に関して言うと、多分自分が父親になって、で血縁と一緒に過ごす時間っていうもののこうどちらが子供にとって大事なのかみたいなことってかなり切実な問題で一緒にいる時間が極端に少ないんで父親としてはその辺はこう自分の人生の悩みみたいなものが
films after, like Father, like Son, becoming a father of myself, I began to think of blood relations. And having spent a lot of time away, having spent time away from my child, I began to think of what is it that makes a father a father?
I wonder if one of the films you might be thinking about is Distance. At the very end of it, there's a burning scene, and the last word, I think, is father. I hope we'll talk about that in class tomorrow.
So from what I learned, the after storm is actually translated, translated from deeper than the sea, from Japanese. So I'm wondering, like, where does the deeper than the sea title come from, and how do you see the difference from the two translations?
My titles aren't necessarily transliterations, and so.
大体いつもインターナショナルタイトルは最近はずっと感想のエージェントと一緒に考えるっていうことが多いですね。
International titles are usually determined in a collaboration with a French.
And so my staff comes up with, they come up with great titles. But I
別にあの同じ役者とチームを組んでそこにでこう固定化することがいいとは思わないんですけど、そんなにでも日本の役者ってね、ここだけの話にならないか、ここだけの話そんなに上手な人多くない。
It's not that I want to, you know, have only a certain number of actors be in my star in my films. It's just that, and this is just between you and me.
とかほとんど動いてないんじゃないかな。ミックスでそれはあのそういうスタイルを選んだというか聞こえはいいけど動かせなかったってことなんだよな。
So in Mamoroshi, yes, I, there wasn't much movement and maybe because I simply couldn't.
動かすの実は動かすの大変なんです。
It's just like the truth of moving a camera takes a lot of work.
The
cameras are.It's not that the cameras are heavy.
動きながらなおかついいポジション、いい構図を維持するっていうのが結構大変な作業ではあるんです。
To capture a great shot while moving and holding a camera is pretty difficult.
でもあの作品によっては、例えばさっきの空気人形なんかはあのリンリンっていう非常に僕は尊敬している台湾のカメラマンですけども、彼なんかは基本的に言うと大体動いてるんでね。だから僕がこれもだからスタイルがもちろん決まっている監督もいるかもしれないですし、その方が安定はするんでしょうけど、意外と作品に応じてカメラマンをチョイスして、その方の持っているスタイルをうまく使い分けるって言ってたんですけど、今度のアフターザストームなんかはずっと一緒に組んでる古い付き合いの
So in Airdoll, the cameraman was a Taiwanese
Mark
Lee, and he was a cameraman that liked to move around. If you ask me, it really depends on the camera person and his or her style. And you can see in After the Storm. The cameraman did not rely on a lot of motion.
ライフ・アガヤクさんと、アワイトル・シスターは、竹本さんっていうカメラマンだと思いますが、結構動いてる。
In My Father, Like Son, and my little sister, Umimachi, the cameraman, Takimoto-san, shot both, and there is a lot of
motion. 基本的にはそんなに動き回る。まあ、あのカメラはもう年齢のせいで目がついていかないので編集もこう何て言うんですか細かいだけじゃなくて、でもこれは誰に教えられた誰に教えられたのかな、やっぱそのシーンを撮るカメラポジションというのはベストなポジションが一つある、ベストなポジションが一つだけ、それを見つける作業が多分監督とカメラマンにとっては一番大事で、それが見つかってないのにいくら積み重ねても全然その種類がないと思ってます。だからまずそれをマスターポジションって呼んでもいいんですけど、マスターポジションにつけてそこで押せるんだったらそのワンカットです。そこで押せないシーンであればそれを基準にして、じゃあ何度もカットを重ねていくことでそのシーンが成立するかっていうことは考えますけど、まずその一 番そのシーンを撮る上で一番いいポジションはどこかっていうのを探すっていうのが大事なんじゃないですか。
So who knows? Maybe it's age. Maybe my eyesight's failing. Maybe I just no longer have the patience to do all of the complicated editing. Maybe it depends on who I was taught by. But in the end, a good scene. There is only one good scene, and you have to find it. And it depends on the cooperation between the director and the camera. And that scene is called the master position. And whether that involves movement or stability depends on what that master position is, what that cut is.
Thank you. We'll take one more question and then close the formal part of this. And there's someone in the back who's been waiting. Yes, please. Would you stand up so we can hear you?
Someone already mentioned how you cast the same kind of actors a lot in the film. And I was wondering, as you mentioned, that there are not that many Japanese actors who are that well of acting, but when you do try casting, what are some aspects
Maybe I said too much when I said that there were no or few. Exactly. Young people. Daimi-san is the same. Even 20s, 30s, there are quite,
there are increasing number of young actors in their 20s and 30s who want to act in good quality films. So basically, my criteria in selecting an individual in a casting call is what is I need them, and I have a sense of whether I want to use them or not in film.
This is not type or not.
Yes, it doesn't have to do with my type or type of individual. I meet them, I go home, and I think of whether that actor will facilitate the progression of the story, the narrative, and that's basically how I determine. So it's not that I have a concrete image from the very beginning. The audition occurs and the script is provided, and then after I meet the actor, I rewrite the script. And it's at that point when I can say yes, that's him or her.
So quite nice.
For me, voice is very important.
For me, voice is very important.
So in the case of in the film My Little Sister, four sisters involved, and I there were many girls, women in their teens and 20s who auditioned, but my criteria was based on the balance of those four voices of the girls, of the women. The rhythm of their voices, the quality of their voices together, individually, apart, and the overall balance of their voices. That's what I took into consideration.
Thank you all very much for these great questions. you to join me once more in thanking our guest, Kore-san. She had snacks for Kore-san. She's thought of everything. So thank you.